Let me tell you about a band named Japan. I'm sure you haven't heard of them, and there's a good reason for that. For just when they were making it big, they called it quits. Now, there's multiple reasons for this, but let's not dive into that just yet. Let me give you a basic introduction. At the time of the release of their seminal record, Quiet Life, there was 5 members. Steve Jansen, David Sylvian, Mick Karn, Richard Barbieri, and Rob Dean. Of those 5 members, the founders were Karn, Sylvian, and Jansen. Those 3 together formed the band in 1974, just as a musical outlet to express themselves. At this time, they were still youngsters, attending their local boys' school in South London. They primarily played together just as an escape from their surroundings. And in June of that year, they had their first public performance at Karn's brother's wedding reception. Sometime after their first performance, Karn ended up talking with a friend in school, Richard Barbieri, who'd become their keyboardist, and invited him to a rehearsal that they were having later that day. This got Barbieri interested in joining the group, and even though he didn't have any experience with music, he had a job at a local bank in town. So, it worked out, and he ended up joining the band. On the other hand, Rob Dean joined in 1976, right around the time Simon Napier Bell agreed to manage the band. Napier Bell would later go on to manage groups like Asia and Wham. Now that things were coming together, Japan entered a talent competition hosted by Hansa Records out of Germany. Unfortunately, they came runners-up to The Cure, but they still got a record deal, and so they began the production process of their first record, Adolescent Sex. The album had a very rough and aggressive glam rock sound, the likes of which wouldn't be seen on many of their records past this. Unfortunately, the record wasn't very successful in the United Kingdom, although in Japan it reached number 20 on the Oricon album charts, and found some minor success in the Netherlands as well. Overall, there was very little fanfare for the album, and David Sylvian himself said he had regretted making the record. This didn't stop the band though, as later that year in 1978, they released their second album, Obscure Alternatives. This was a work the band was much more proud of, and again, just like the first album, it only really found success in Japan and the Netherlands. The sound was a little more refined, and had hints towards what was to come. Sometime after the release of Obscure Alternatives, the band went on to work with Giorgio Moroder. Together, they would go on to make a track called Life in Tokyo. As opposed to their gritty, rough around the edges rock sound before, this was disco, and although they didn't stick with a sound like this, it would influence them in the future. And once again, it failed to chart in the UK, and sought very little popularity. Going forward, they went on to work on Quiet Life, their third record. This album marked the major shift in their sound, and instead of being more guitar-focused, there was more emphasis on Richard Barbieri's synthesizers, which lent a great atmosphere to the record. In addition, David Sylvian's vocals had begun to mature. Overall, the sound that they had produced was much more sophisticated than their prior work. But again, the album and their singles accompanying just were not successful in their home country. With this astounding lack of success, they were dropped by the record label. This didn't stop them though, as shortly after they were dropped, they were signed on by Virgin Records. Under Virgin, they would release 2 final studio albums, Gentlemen Take Polaroids and Tin Drum. Gentlemen Take Polaroids took that Quiet Life sound and refined it even further, creating something much more experimental than anything they've done before. But at this point, relations in the band were becoming strained, as Sylvian, the de facto leader of the group, became, in his own words, a paranoid perfectionist. No longer were the albums truly collaborative works, as Sylvian was domineering the sessions. Shortly after the release of this album, Rob Dean left the band, and he went on to work with the likes of Gary Numan. On top of all this, the album's commercial success was much like the others. Even with the further refinement of their sound, they weren't reaching the success they had hoped for, and it looked like the future of the group was looking grim. A year after release of Gentlemen Take Polaroids in 1980, Tin Drum, their final record as a group, was released. This album took the sound they developed in Gentlemen Take Polaroids and fused it with traditional East Asian music, and while cracks were forming in the group, this was probably their first commercial success, and unfortunately, their last in this form. Tensions had finally let loose in the band, as Karn's girlfriend, Yuka Fuji, left Karn for Sylvian. And as Roger Waters would say, it was a spent force creatively. They went on one final tour, and their most successful at that. And after the tour concluded, the group was a done deal. There was only one last release by the group, Oil on Canvas, a live album of one of their final performances at the Hammersmith Odeon. This live album was their most successful yet, as it charted number 5 on the UK albums chart, and charted in many other countries. And with this newfound popularity, even though the band had dissolved, many of their albums started to sell much more. And albums like Quiet Life, Gentlemen Take Polaroids, and Tin Drum actually went gold. But by this time, the group had moved long past it. Mick Karn had started working on his own solo work, same with Sylvian, and they'd all effectively split up. Through the rest of the 1980s, they scarcely collaborated. And only in 1989 did they come back under a different name, Raintree Crow. Their first and only album under that name, Raintree Crow, was released in 1991. The album had a much darker sound, reflecting some of Sylvian's own solo work. Raintree Crow was a project initially meant to last much longer than it did. They disbanded for many of the same reasons as they did in Japan. After all was said and done, the band split up for good. They all continued working on their own projects and working with others. And so at this point, Japan was effectively entirely defunct. In the modern day, the fate of the members of Japan are as such. Steve Jansen is still playing music and releasing his own records even to this day. David Sylvian has since retired from making music and is still reclusive as he once was. In present day, Rob Dean works as an ornithologist in Central America. Richard Barbieri still works on his own music, in addition to working with Porcupine Tree. Mick Karn unfortunately passed away in 2011 after a serious bout of cancer. Thank you for joining me on this brief journey into the history of Japan. If you'd like to know anything else, just ask me, and I'd be happy to help.
Wow.